The power consumed by the heat pump. Again, you assume it's a steady operating condition, so there are no storms outside. Your network input is your QH, so from the higher quality heat to a, which is your higher heat reservoir, the house, to with this, and your the COP of your heat pump. So 80,000 kilojoules per hour over 2.5 is 32,000 kilojoules per hour. If you wish, divide by 3,600 to get 8.9 kilowatts. So kilojoules per second. Yep. All good? Yes. So, the rate at which the heat is absorbed from the cold outdoor air. Now, the house is losing heat at 80,000 kilojoules per hour. The energy must be balanced to maintain a constant temperature. So, QL, your lower quality heat equals QH minus the network. So 48,000 kilojoules of heat. So you're effectively stealing 48,000 kilojoules of per hour of free energy from the atmosphere and putting it inside your house. Now, as I mentioned, when the temperature is below zero, this is not very efficient. So a lot of times you try to get that heat from underground resources. But the new technologies also include using thermal solar thermal reservoirs. So let's say in Norway, they're using solar thermal equipment. So at vacuum, you have these vacuum pipes with the little solar thermal absorbers, and you can heat the house, inside the house, to let's say 25 degrees, 20 degrees, while the temperature outside might be minus 15 degrees, because you're converting radiation into heat. So that's another thing, that's another technology that is being implemented into heat pumps. Actually, one of my friends from who is a graduate of this university just took over the family company of 4,000 employees who their innovative equipment is using, converting solar thermal energy into the energy required to drive a heat pump. So they can also cool down using heat. So converting that heat into electricity, into energy to drive their compressors to cool down inside the house as well. Most commonly the problem involves, with reverse heat engines, the most common problem involves moving a specific amount of heat from cold to a hot reservoir. So again, remember you're moving, you're not transforming the energy, you're just moving it around. So that's why the efficiency is different. Using an irreversible cycle to do this requires extra work input to compensate for the irreversibilities. And unfortunately, all real refrigerators and heat pumps are irreversible. I think I mentioned that quite a few times today. Express energy quality. This is the final part of the lecture. We're going to talk about Clausius inequalities. You may at one point use these. Some point. Express the energy quality mathematically. Take the ratio of heat contribution in the Carnot cycle. So QH over QC, the higher quality heat over the lower quality heat, equals RTH log of P2 over P1. I think you all remember that equation. It's your work. Equals RTC log of P4 over P3. So when you're doing work, you're doing compression. So that's why you can convert your network to the work equation. Equals the volume work equation. Equals minus TH over TC. Hence, cancelling and rearranging gives you QH over TH plus QC over TC equals zero. This is apparently intriguing because the sum of QH plus QC is not zero, but quality related to Q over T sums to zero over a cycle. So the sum is never zero, but it's in respect with the temperature of the reservoirs over a cycle. So temperature, the energy balance becomes zero for an ideal system over the full cycle because you're heating and cooling. Is this the case for any reversible cycle? the PV diagram of, this is a PV diagram of arbitrary system. So when you heat up, you increase the pressure, you put work in, you increase the pressure, and then when you release the heat, you decrease the pressure, change the volume. So this is effectively the PV diagram of the cycle. This figure also shows an attempt to approximate this arbitrary cycle by a discrete series of Carnot cycles, a different Carnot cycle overall. As a first step, it is necessary to show that this doesn't change the network. To do this, focus on one of the isotherms, the process path, let's say A to B. So from A to B is replaced by two adiabatic processes, A1, A2-1, and then 3 to B, and then the isothermal process 1, 2, 3. So this is just simulating the same work using a PV diagram. Consider the heat exchange. The first law is applied to both paths between A and B, leading to UA minus UB equals QA to B, so the QA to B, plus the work input of A to B, so A to B, and UA minus UB equals QA 1, 2, 3, B, for the full cycle, plus the work 1, 2, 3, B. As the work equals A to B, equals work A, 1, 2, 3, B. So it's just a different process path. So you can either take the direct route or the cyclic route. But the cyclic route is your Carnot cycle. Then the amount of heat exchanged must also be the same. So Q A to B equals Q A, 1, 2, 3, B. So the energy, basically the energy balances whatever route you take to meet the final destination of your compression. So think of it as a vector. If you go one A, B, C, or A, D, C, you go through the same amount of distance, you always get the same amount of energy. So it's effectively a vector. It is not possible to guarantee that the temperature at which the heat is exchanged is the same along both paths. In most cases, so the temperature exchange might not be the same, but energy is. It's just at what point, how much energy is transferred. Returning to the Q over T terms for the ith cycle of the Carnot cycles, this becomes, so these are different, I, J, K usually denotes what cycles and what parameters you use. You use it a lot in programming. QHI over THI plus QCI over TCI equals zero. And for the entire original cycle, we find that the sum of the Carnot cycles, so different cycles to meet that specification, equals QHI over THI plus QCI over TCI. Now, you can have as many Carnot cycles and different parameters and effectively put loops to calculate the final, to balance that equation to zero at any point, you can calculate what QH, I, J, K, whatever is using that program, that loop. It's a little programming for you. Returning in terms of isotherm leads to all isotherms, sum of the J, QJ over TJ equals zero. Hence, this is essentially a sum over all heat contributions from a discrete number of Carnot cycles, so separate number of Carnot cycles. Taking the limit of an infinite number of cycles, this becomes dq, the integral of dq over t with respect to r. So this is with respect to reversibility. If one of the cycles is irreversible, then the efficiency of the irreversible cycle is lower than the Carnot cycle, hence W work of irreversible cycle over QH of irreversible cycle is lower than TH minus TC over TC. Substituting the first law into the numerator to get QH irreversible minus QC irreversible over QH irreversible is lower than 1 minus TC over TH, hence 1 minus QC irreversible over QH irreversible is lower than 1 minus TC over TH. So the energy efficiency is always lower. Dropping the absolute notations and noting that QC irreversible and QH irreversible always have opposite signs gives you QC irreversible over QH irreversible minus TC over TH. So it's always lower. That, the whole point of the Clausius inequality is to emphasize that point, that ideality and non-ideality is always going to be different, reversible and irreversible systems. So QC irreversible over TC plus QH irreversible over TH is always going to be lower, less than zero, so always negative. The conclusion is that for irreversible cycles, dq over t is always, for irreversible systems, always lower than zero. And combining the two results leads to the Clausius inequality, which for all cycles, reversible or irreversible, is written as dq over t is either lower than or equal to zero. The integrals having the same quality of energy property seen before. So for a reversible cycle, all the overall energy quality is not changed, and for the reversible cycle, it is reduced. So it's either going to be equal or lower, the quality, the overall quality of energy. So higher temperature, higher quality, lower temperature, lower quality. So the overall quality with the work. If the cycle is reversible, return to equality, dq over t equals zero. This is a general and applies all possible reversible paths. All thermodynamic properties must sum to zero over a cycle, reversible otherwise. Hence, dp equals zero, dv equals zero, dt equals zero, and du equals zero, and dh equals zero. So all of them will equal zero, and this is the principle of thermodynamics. And you'll see it over and over in the next couple of years, and if you choose for the rest of your life, depending on your career paths. So comparing this last result to the previous one, and we see immediately that dq over t reversible must be a state variable and equal to dy, where y is the new thermodynamic property. So it's constant. You can determine various different parameters from dq over t because of that. It's a state variable. It's like your PVT. This new property is called entropy, which we'll cover next in the next lecture, and it's topic 5, and takes the symbol S. Differential changes in entropy are given by ds equals dq over t reversible or dq reversible tds. Entropy change of a system undergoing a process may be found by integrating this expression along some reversible path. Any reversible path joining the two ends states may be chosen. So the change in entropy is between two points, two and one, or whatever the point is, with respect to the change in heat over temperature. So entropy change allows us to quantify a discussion around energy quality. So energy entropy can be used to describe the quality of this energy. As entropy increases, energy quality goes down. Entropy decreases, energy quality goes up. So remember, entropy is the imbalance around the universe. So if you, let's say your room is very messy, it has a very high entropy, so the quality of your life within that room is lower, and various different things. So when you tidy it up, the entropy decreases, the quality increases. It is intuitively clear that the overall entropy will probably be equal to zero for reversible processes, greater than zero for irreversible processes, and the entropy overall goes down, then the process will probably be impossible. So the entropy of the universe increases with any chemical process, any process, any energy transfer. The entropy of the universe always increases. All this will be proved and explored in more details in topic 5. So that's the end of our lecture for today.